I kind of want to start with the kind of the main subject of the evening, the King Elvis. And I kind of want to know for each of you, kind of as creators and as performers, what was your relationship to Elvis before this production? And then how has this process kind of changed the way that you see or relate to him?
When I was really little, he was still in what I say is his hot, like, movie phase. And being that age, I didn't know that the movies were bad B movies. I just know that there was this hot guy and who could sing and dance really beautifully and have all these girls around him all the time. And so that was Saturday afternoon movie fodder on television in Nashville in those days, growing up in the 60s. And so that was my first. Then I got cool in high school, and Elvis became uncool, and the Beatles and the Stones got cool, and Elvis was in sequins and jumpsuits in Vegas, you know, blurring out his last hits in that first kind of, you know, crank them out near the end type of a prototype. And so I wasn't into Elvis. So I went through a whole period where Elvis was uncool and I was becoming an artist in Nashville, Tennessee with modern dance and things like that, and working my way out of musical theater and into modern dance. So that's my first relationship to Elvis, dual.
When I was a kid, I remember the day Elvis died. I was 5. I was in my mom's living room with my aunt. And when I was about 12, my aunt gave me a box of all these newspaper clippings, which were from Elvis, because she was a big fan. So that was my introduction into idolizing somebody, a celebrity. And then when I was 13, Madonna became my Elvis. And the first thing I started collecting was newspaper clippings.
I grew up listening to Elvis somewhat. My mom is Cuban and came over during the Mariel Boatlift, and so she would play a lot of the band music from Cuba. So we listened to a lot of the Beatles and Elvis and all this music. So growing up, I would hear it a lot, and I wouldn't associate it specifically with anything, but it stayed within my DNA of just like memory. And so rehearing this reminds me of family or home, and in a weird way, because then I see these twists that are going on that, as a 5-year-old, just hearing it in the background, I didn't know exactly what was going on.
Same, just growing up hearing it from my grandparents and my mother. A lot of movie references, for example, Lilo and Stitch, Hound Dog was something very popular during my growing up. And then growing to love rock and roll and to grow to love this experience with Mark made me grow to appreciate and love Elvis, and also to be so close to Mark, and then also see that as something very close to his heart, so it became close to my heart as well. And then I had to do my research as well, because I just couldn't come out here and give him props and different things to do and not know my history, so it made me learn a lot as well.
Yeah, my start of Elvis came from my mom, actually, who's like in love with Elvis, and she got to be here tonight, so I was really thankful for that. But her being able to like show me Elvis movies, she's all the time playing music and things like that. And just quick story, impersonators, I guess, is who I saw Elvis as the most. And there was a time when she wanted Love Me Tender played to her. So as a small child, I think I was 8, she gave me a note that said, "Will you play Love Me Tender to my mommy?" So here I go, like, to the stage, and Elvis the impersonator came down and sang that song. So that's where I have the connection with Elvis, is with my mom.
Frankie, you mentioned kind of the movement of Elvis, and I think one of the things that we're kind of reminded of watching this show is how much the moves really define him, and how these iconic moves, these iconic poses, the hip swivels and the arm rolls and all this stuff. And so can you talk a little bit about how the movement and the physicality of Elvis kind of provided a seed for this production and to kind of serve as a type of entry point into him and what he stood for?
When I started doing the research, which came, I was doing a piece about war, and I was looking up Rumsfeld's famous, whatever that convoluted thing he said was. Do you, you know what I'm talking about? It doesn't come to my mind. But that answer that he gave in the press briefing that was absolutely ridiculous. And so I was looking for that on the computer, and this Elvis thing came up. And at the same time, I was doing a Kronos at 40 tribute at Lincoln Center, and Elvis Everywhere, the finale of this piece, was one of the pieces of music I had chosen. So I thought, and I just kind of clocked those two things in the back of my head. And so that later went into a anti-war piece and then found its way into Elvis Everywhere. But the movement where the research led me was into cultural appropriation, and that these moves were taken from James Brown and Little Richard and the Sam Phillips in Memphis was famous for saying, if I could find me a white man who could sing like a Negro, I would make $1 million. And so he was constantly in search of that, knowing that that was true. And of course that was true with Elvis, because he also had the moves. And Elvis went across town in Tupelo and went to the black churches and was a part of the music scene there, did the same in Memphis when they moved to Memphis, went to the black nightclubs and learned the dances. And he was totally steeped in that culture, not just copying it, but truly, I mean, he wasn't copying it as a rip-off type of thing in his head. He was generally moved by it, and genuinely, excuse me, moved by it and inspired by it. So that's where that kind of cross-pollination came for me, and is the most interesting thing about the movement part of it.
Mm-hmm. And for the dancers, kind of what was your experience kind of embodying that and using that as kind of a tool to kind of embody Elvis as a character in this work?
Yeah, I would say actually the first day of residence here at Jacob's Pillow, the first thing that Mark did was do a pelvic exploration. He didn't say anything more than that. He just had us all come into the space and start to explore any way that the pelvis can move. And he started he went to the simplest. He said, go to the bone. And where do you go? And then go to the muscles and then slowly grow out of there. And then it slowly built to, how does it propel you through a space? How do you go down into the floor? How does it lift you up, push you towards someone else? And so it really went from a really human internal place to find that external. And so it slowly built from there. That's actually where the trouble, that section trouble, where I'm doing the thing, that section was built from that, of everyone exploring. And then we were teaching each other phrases that we created from our pelvic explorations. I mean, we also watched a lot of Elvis videos. He had us watch a lot, the nitty gritty, people copying Elvis impersonators, also the fan section. We went back and researched, we each had to find. And that was from Elvis fans all the way to Justin Bieber fans. We were trying to see the whole spectrum of all the way to now, the fandom of it, and the faces that, from grabbing their hand to wanting to photograph with them. And so we each had to find 15 different faces that would represent our way of connecting to the king.
When we usually think of Elvis, we don't often think of him kind of in encounters with Donald Rumsfeld. We don't think of him kind of necessarily sharing, you know, visiting the Oval Office with Nixon, but that's a very big part of this piece, and you clearly wanted to put a political context on this, which is something that you do in a lot of your work. And as Pamela noted before the show, this is something that the two of you, kind of going back to 2008 when you started really ramping up your collaboration, was a goal of yours. And so I wonder if you could kind of talk about you know, what was it about that time? What happened in 2008 that kind of made you really want to make that shift in your work to kind of move away from the type of personal works that you had been focusing on and looking kind of at broader political issues and weaving that into the work, still having fun, you know, and still giving us like a good time, but making a really strong political statement as well. So for the two of you, what were those conversations like and how did that evolve?
Well, we met on Taboo, and so we
2003,
and we're doing a Broadway musical, which was, in some ways, my story, because it was the Boy George Lee Bowery story, so I certainly had identification with it, but it was bigger than me, and everything up until that point had been about me and my experience. And I kind of realized at that point, and through working with Stephen, that there were only so many pieces you can make about yourself, you know, before you get bored and probably the audience gets bored. And there was so much autobiographical work and so much work around gender and gender exploration, but also my relationship to who were my icons. And so we just decided, we were inspired politically by what was going on and this trend we saw in the country of, you know, this kind of horrific right. I was a Rachel Maddow fan before it was fashionable. You know, to say I saw this coming, I saw it coming, but I once I knew it was inevitable, I wasn't like, oh yes, this piece is gonna be great because of it. I was like, oh no, you know. But I don't know, what do you want to say about that, Stephen? Our political...
I think we both worked in commercial theater and we got burned by it and we needed to get serious again. And I think it was, Mark wanted to go back to the dance world that he started in and I wanted to help him get back there because I think Mark's a genius artist.
I wanted my autonomy back.
He wanted his autonomy and I wanted his voice heard. And yeah, I think it was just about go back to basics, but get serious but entertain. I think that's the biggest thing about us. We want to entertain you. You know, we want you to have fun, but we want you to think at the same time. And I think just getting older as well, you have a different perspective on things, you know, and that's part of it.
And for the dancers, how you kind of bring characterization into the dance that you do.
Yeah, so just a specific example from this piece. I can remember Mark giving me specific directions of, for the last Elvis Everywhere, to tap into the demons that Elvis was kind of like having and that kind of downward spiral. And for the longest, like I couldn't figure out how to portray that until we started doing research and tapping into the videos of his last performances. And like, you can see like in the very last projection of him like stumbling with his words. And it wasn't until then that I could research and figure out kind of where he was coming from, what was going on in his life at the time. I mean, it was really interesting to bring that kind of Elvis character to the end versus like the young peppy Elvis that happens at the beginning. That's just a prime example of how we tapped into those different characters and personalities that Elvis did have.
As you can see, there are different pieces. So for me, I tried to make it very personal, but at first it was very hard to not act to come from a real place, like from the heart. And for example, with me and London's Doulette, for that was an example of cultural appropriation with me doing my dance and him doing it. But then I thought of it from a standpoint if London wanted to be the next Justin Bieber or Justin Timberlake and he was like, Frankie, can you teach me to dance? Like I would be like, of course, like, yeah. So I had to look at it from that way and not from a place of strife. And then also with my solo from the Heartbreak Hotel, for me, I've gone through a personal experience of loving someone and not being able to be with them because you know that you may be their downfall or they may be your downfall, so you would rather be lonely than to be with them because you love yourself and that person that much that you would rather be lonely to go through that circumstance. So that was something personal. And then also every time I'm dancing with the company, just taking in that moment and just smiling when I can. And also with the running solo, just thinking about I wasn't alive during the cotton era, but doing it from an ancestor standpoint and appreciation kind of way. So just making everything real from the dance theater's standpoint.
Give us a room with a view of the beautiful Rhine. Give us a room with a view of the beautiful Rhine. Give me a muddy old creek in Texas any old time. I got those 1, 2, 3, 4 occupation GI blues. From my GI hat to the heels of my GI shoes. And if I don't go stateside soon, I'm gonna blow my fuse. We'll get Hoss and Pfeffer and Black Pumpernickel for chow.